So it's a topic that's a good sort of
let us begin the last of the sessions today, and this will be on antitrust and business law. As you can see in your program, we have three papers, and the way we have organized ourselves is for the presenter to go first, as in the last panel. The academic commenter will go second, and the practitioner commenter will go third. So we don't have an overall commenter. We have three participants per paper, with the presenter going first, the academic commenter going second, and the practitioner commenter going third. Each of the three papers aspire to give the paper presenter a few minutes at the end to comment on the commenters, and we will see how that goes. The one rule that I would ask the panelists to abide by is to turn your microphone off after you are finished speaking. The way the electronics work here is that there cannot be more than three microphones on at the same time, and since I am the timekeeper, I will need to have my microphone on to say ding with about a minute to go so that we try to stay on schedule. Okay, so I'm going to allow each panel, I guess maybe the practitioner on each panel, can briefly introduce, at least by name, the presenter, the academic commenter, and yourself, and we'll be off and running. Thank you.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Elai Katz, and we have here our first paper is a paper by Samuel Weinstein. It's called Financial Regulation in the Receding Shadow of Antitrust. Because time is so short, I'm actually going to dispense with introductions of bios, just we'll turn right to the paper. Hopefully you can look that up. The academic discussant or commenter is Larry White, and I will take just a few minutes after that to say a few things on my own. So, Sam, when you're ready, please get started.
Okay, thanks so much for having me. I'm very happy to be here. So I'm going to talk about my paper here, as Elai was saying, the financial regulation and the receding shadow of antitrust. And this is a paper about the relationship between antitrust and regulation. And in particular, it's looking at what I see as a competitive problem. Okay, and the competitive problem is based on the idea of implied antitrust immunity. Now, this is a doctrine that basically says when there's a regulatory scheme in place, in certain cases, antitrust might be ousted from the regulated market. Okay. So the question is, when antitrust is ousted from a regulated market, what happens? Who steps in? Well, the idea behind implied antitrust immunity is that the sector regulator will, quote, play the antitrust role, right? The sector regulator, the expert regulator, let's say the SEC, will step in and play that role. So that leads to the question, do the sector regulators do this? And if they do this, do they do it well? And as I'll get to in the paper, I think the answer to both of those things is no. They don't want to do it in many cases, and they don't do it particularly well for a number of reasons, which I'll get into. So the paper poses this problem. It says, in certain markets, and particularly the financial markets, we're seeing antitrust potentially ousted from the market, right, with the idea that the SEC and the CFTC are going to step in, but they're not. So we're left with a gap. And how do you fill that gap? Well, the proposal I have here is what I call a regulatory design solution, so structural regulation that sets up markets either through rulemakings by the agencies or through legislation to take away the possibility of competitive harm. And I'll get into a case study here, which is the derivatives markets. So let me talk a little bit about the antitrust regulation balance. So we have about 40 or 50 years of case law. If you're an antitrust lawyer, you've probably read some of this case law, talking about when antitrust might be ousted from a regulated market. Okay, and we have these theories. So one is implied antitrust immunity, but that's not the only one. You might see other explanations for why, when there's a regulatory structure, we don't want to have antitrust. And the language that the court uses is when there's a plain repugnancy between antitrust and the regulatory structure, or when antitrust would stop the regulatory structure from working, antitrust will be ousted from the market. And you can see why this would make sense, right? So if the regulation says companies may get together to jointly bid, and they may discuss their prices ahead of time in certain financial products. We don't want them to be subject to antitrust liability for doing what the regulation says they can do, right? So this makes a lot of sense in some cases. Now, for a long time, until the 2000s, courts strictly limited this theory of implied antitrust immunity, right? So it was hard for a defendant to get away with what would otherwise be harmful actions under the antitrust laws based on this defense. But in the 2000s, we get these two cases, right, that we've heard mentioned today. The first in 2004 was Trinco. The second in 2007 was Credit Suisse. I'll start with Credit Suisse. Credit Suisse does a lot of things. One thing that stands out in Credit Suisse is it says, on the facts of this case, we don't have a conflict between the securities laws and the antitrust laws. But you know what? Down the road, we might. And for that reason, we're going to bar antitrust from interceding in this case, right? So antitrust lawyers and enforcers read this particular part of the opinion and thought, wow, that's pretty sweeping potentially, right? If any future conflict is enough to bar antitrust, we might really be seeing a shift in the balance here toward regulation and away from antitrust. Now, Trinco precedes Credit Suisse. It does a little bit less because there's an antitrust savings clause in that case that doesn't allow for implied antitrust immunity. But it has this language in dicta that says, you know, this would be a great case for implied antitrust immunity if there wasn't the antitrust savings clause. But courts, you should think about the regulatory context even when there is an antitrust savings clause and ask, is the regulation playing the competition role? If it is, maybe you don't need antitrust anymore, right, in those types of cases. So in the wake of these two cases, one after the other, essentially, you get a lot of concern among antitrust enforcers. What's going to happen here, right? Are we ousted from these markets? So when I started to do the paper, I said I'm going to read all the cases that where Credit Suisse was posed as a defense. Same with Trinco, right? And I expected to see going in, well, essentially antitrust is going to be ousted from regulated markets. But that's not what's happening. So the lower courts outside of the financial markets have been very careful about applying Credit Suisse, at least in the cases I've seen. And they read both Credit Suisse and Trinco quite narrowly. So in a case involving airline regulation or FERC regulations or regulation of horse racing, defendants will come and say, look, there's a regulatory structure here. Credit Suisse says you can't reach my anti-competitive conduct. And the court said, no, that's not true. We're going to read Credit Suisse quite narrowly to apply to the securities markets. Same with Trinco. So parties have come, like in the healthcare mergers we just saw, in a case involving the Orange Book, have come forward and said, Trinco says you should take regulation to account. And if there's a regulatory structure that plays the competition role, antitrust should be ousted. And courts, again, have mostly said, no, that's not how we're going to look at this. We're going to leave antitrust in place in most cases. So the impact of these cases, Credit Suisse and Trinco, has mostly been in the financial markets. And even there, outside of the securities context, you'll see defendants coming forth with Credit Suisse defenses in court saying, unless it's actually a securities case, so if there's an IRS reg, we're not going to apply Credit Suisse, right? So quite narrow, which I think is one contribution to the paper, I hope, is to say that some of the worry we had might not have been justified. But why should we worry in the financial markets? Well, as I mentioned at the beginning, when antitrust is ousted, we expect that the sector regulators will come in and play the antitrust role. And that would be great if they did it, right? So we could expect that they might do a good job. But there are a number of reasons why we think they won't. And this is work that's been done by Mark Lemley and others. So we think they won't do a good job because competition is not their primary mission. They don't have the resources to do it. Competition enforcement might clash with other priorities, say systemic soundness, right? And these agencies are more subject to capture than an antitrust court. So there's an empirical question here. Can we find out, right? Do sector regulators do their job? Do they play the competition role? And I do a little bit of looking at this in the paper, and I say, the answer looks like no. And why does it look like no? So I talked to the SEC and the CFTC personnel there and asked, do you have competition lawyers? Is there anyone at the agency who is expert in this? And the answer I got most of the time was no, right? We don't have any dedicated competition personnel. We can draft people into it if we need to, if we're working with DOJ on, say, a LIBOR case, right? But we don't have anyone who does it. So that's kind of a bad sign, right, if you expect them to play the competition role. And then you can look at the cases they bring, and I've started to do this, and it looks to me like there are hardly any or maybe no independent competition matters being pursued, right? So what would a competition matter look like at one of these places? Well, maybe an access, right, access to a clearinghouse, that type of thing. So I'm just not finding those cases, which leads me to believe that the theory, right, that they're not going to be good at this is being borne out by the facts. So what do? You have antitrust immunity, but no agency enforcement of competition in these financial markets, potentially. So the argument I have is let's put forth a structural solution, right? So let's structure the markets ex ante so that we have less competition problems, right? Because we can't trust the sector regulators ex post to do the enforcement. the case study in the paper is about the derivatives markets, right? So we know about Dodd-Frank. So one thing Dodd-Frank does, among many other things, is it regulates the derivatives markets for the first time. And the goal of Dodd-Frank, right, is to move swaps out of over-the-counter trading and into central clearing and exchange trading, right? So exchange trading makes the markets less opaque. Central clearing, at least in theory, makes them safer, although you get arguments about that. And the idea is, in the end, you're going to greatly reduce over-the-counter swaps, which we think might have been a great cause of the financial crisis, right? So here's what it does, right? In doing this sort of systemic safety stuff, it creates these bottlenecks, right? So if you want to trade derivatives, you need to get access to a swap execution facility or a market like that, and you need access to a clearinghouse, right? You can't do most of your trades unless you have access to one of these facilities. So this sets up a problem, right? You know, potentially, right? It could look like Terminal Railroad. We own the only bridge over the Mississippi, right? So now, whoever owns these clearinghouses or exchanges can disadvantage their rivals. And how would they do it? Well, we've seen a case out there, a class action about credit default swaps. The way they do it is they get on the risk committees, they dominate the risk committees, and they say to their rivals, you know, you look pretty risky. We're not going to allow you to trade on the clearinghouse, right? In fact, the only people who aren't risky are us, right? Coincidentally. So they abuse their position on these.
One minute.
Okay, they abuse their position on these clearinghouses and SEFs. So here are the potential solutions. So my solution is one that's already been proposed. So the CFTC and SEC in 2010 proposed ownership caps on the big banks in clearinghouses and SEFs. The rules were never finalized, not surprisingly. The big banks opposed them. DOJ wanted stricter rules. And I argue in the paper that the CFTC and SEC ownership caps are the way to go in a market like this, and perhaps in other regulated markets where antitrust is ousted, right? For a number of reasons. One is we think the financial regulators are not good at ex post enforcement. Also, if we have ownership caps, the big banks will have to spread out into competing clearinghouses, right? They can't all gather in one. So we might have competition for the market, which we might like. Even if we end up with one, that might be okay. Maybe preferable to antitrust enforcement. This was surprising to me to say this because I'm pro-enforcement mostly. But it's hard to win essential facilities cases, right? It's hard to win these kind of refusal to deal cases. If you set up the markets to avoid the problem, maybe you get more competition, or at least fairer competition. And then this last point about toxic products. So Dan Crane has this idea about markets for toxic products. Antitrust maybe shouldn't be involved. We talked before about when do we want to have less output? Cigarettes, right? We want less output. We don't want lower prices on cigarettes, probably. Depends if you're a smoker. And we might want the same here, right? We might want less output of derivatives, less innovation, and the sector regulators can do that, right? That's something they're good at. So I'll leave it there. Time's up. Thanks.
All right. So let me... From the beginning. All right, that's the highest tech thing I know how to do. First, let me again thank the organizers of this conference. It's been great. Lots of good ideas. Gave me the opportunity to hear good ideas and to read Sam's paper and start thinking about these issues. And so I commend Sam's paper to you. It's clearly written. The ideas are interesting, somewhat provocative. Now, as a good business school professor, of course, I've got to tell you what I'm going to say, then say it, and then tell you what I've said. But also as a good business school professor, I like handing out hard copy of everything I say, and supply will exceed demand. Microeconomics professor, I'm always conscious of supply and demand. So, what's the issue? And the issue, as you just heard from Sam, what do you do when you've got regulation conflicting with antitrust? And this seems to be an especial problem in financial markets. And as he mentioned, Dodd-Frank heightened the issue by directing that derivatives be channeled through central clearinghouses, through exchanges, so heightening this central bottleneck problem, as Sam just mentioned. And of course, there is Credit Suisse and Trinco out there. So that's the basic setup, that's the basic problem. And what does he find? Well, as you heard, Credit Suisse and Trinco have not been as restrictive on antitrust efforts as initially had been feared, but in financial markets, the force of Credit Suisse and Trinco seems to be a bit stronger, and so that conflict is clearly there. And as you just heard, he argues, and I think convincingly, that the regulatory agencies are really not the right place for active antitrust enforcement. They lack the personnel, the expertise, they lack the remedies. I don't think, Sam, you mentioned orally about the remedies. They lack the remedies, and it's low on their list of priorities. I'm going to expand on that a little bit. And so what does he suggest? You heard his structural design approach and his example of the SEC and CFTC proposal on ownership limits and particular rules. You heard his skepticism about using an essential facilities approach, and he reminds us of the toxic output problem. All right, so I've just reviewed now, what can I do? First, I'm a strong believer in lodging antitrust enforcement in the regulatory agencies, and of course, having private action as an available source of enforcement as well. And the regulatory agencies, I want to stress this issue of culture. Yes, it's resources, yes, it's mission, yes, it's remedies, all of which are lacking, but culture matters, and regulatory agencies, if they don't have the right culture, and in this case, an enforcement culture, there just isn't going to be antitrust enforcement. The Securities and Exchange Commission, I think, is a wonderful example of how culture matters. The financial crisis, I'm going to come back to that in just a minute, is at least partially about five large investment banks, household names, that were inadequately regulated by the SEC, inadequately prudentially regulated. Why? Because the SEC didn't have a culture of prudential regulation. They have a culture, as most of us know, of information dispersion, making sure information is getting out to investors into the marketplace, but prudential regulation, not part of their culture. They got handed the regulation of the credit rating agencies a little more than a decade ago. They haven't done very well there. Why? Because, again, regulating the credit rating agencies, and in this case, thinking about competition, is just not part of the culture. You can read their annual reports on the credit rating agencies. Yes, they've got Herfindahl indexes there, but it's very sterile. It's very by the book. The culture just isn't there. Now there is this really fundamental issue. The division has had to worry about what do you do about central facilities that are jointly owned. That's a crucial aspect of the central facility, that they are jointly owned. I'm aware of the division thinking about this in the 1970s in the context of what do you do about the Trans-Alaska pipeline, which was owned by the major petroleum companies that were drilling in North Alaska and sending the oil through the pipeline and then taking it out at the bottom. at the bottom end. Then in the 80s, the multiple listing services. We're talking real estate again. Real estate brokerage, multiple listing services. Again, a central facility, and again, jointly owned.
1 minute.
And so, okay. So, Sam, you know, talks about the problem of, you know, the upstream, you know, where the central facility is being used to disadvantage competition either upstream or downstream by the joint owners. I think it's important to remember that the facility itself can be used as a means of extracting rents. And again, that was the Trans-Alaskan pipeline problem. I would ask, how general is the structural regulatory design approach? How many other applications? Sam's goes into nice detail on the particular CFTC and SEC example, but again, that hasn't even been finalized 8 years after, or 7.5 after Dodd-Frank. And so, you know, how much can this be generalized? And then, you know, who's going to do the design? Is it going to be those regulators who don't have the culture of antitrust enforcement to begin with? Last thing I want to say is that on these toxic type problems, the first best way of dealing with a net harm market is to put a tax on it, an effluent fee, the carbon, you know, carbon tax. And other means, just restricting competition, yes, you get the higher price, yes, there will be less of the toxic product out there, but the participants in the sellers in the marketplace will get the rents if all you do is restrict competition. An effluent fee is a far better way of dealing with it. And then the issue of how important were derivatives in the financial crisis. Yes, they brought AIG down, but you know, that for the rest of the problem, it wasn't derivatives, it was, including AIG, inadequately capitalized large financial institutions who could not absorb the losses on residential mortgages, either directly, indirectly. That's the story. Derivatives, except for AIG, not really an important issue. So, in conclusion, again, we've got a tension here. Structural regulatory design may well be part of the solution, but it would be nice to know how far that can go, and you do have to worry who's going to actually be doing the design. And of course, you know, antitrust and the enforcement agencies ought to have primacy in all of this. Again, I urge you to read Sam's paper. It's a very interesting paper. Thank you.
Elai.
Hi, everyone. Thank you. I'm going to stay here if you don't mind, and I don't have slides. So it is a really good paper, which I commend to you to read for several of the reasons that have already been stated. So I'm going to jump in with a few observations and then some comments that are related directly to the paper. My first observation, which is I think the way I'd like to start thinking about this entire problem, and it is an important problem to have identified, is that to me at least it seems that many of the areas where we have a lot of regulation, and then you have the concern of where should antitrust step back and to what extent should it step back, turns out to be in industries where competition is a little more complicated. It's a little more complicated either because there is a need to collaborate or there's a need to have, or at least a history of having a monopoly. So that's why we see it in telecom, we see it in the financial services. I think it's useful to start by thinking that way, that we end up with a conflict or at least some kind of a turf problem, because to begin with, regulation, not always but often, comes up in areas where competition is a bit different than in you know, really traditional kind of widget manufacturing industries. That's one. The second is that I would want to caution not to overstate. But I don't think you did. I think you were careful to say that the effect wasn't quite as much as people had had feared, and I guess I would add some feared and others hoped, but in any event, the impact wasn't hasn't been quite as great. And I would say, I agree exactly with your description. Very little outside of the financial space, more so in financial areas, but I don't think all that much there either. So when, you know, when Jay files complaints about various, you know, alleged misconduct by banks, I think it's not that often that there either are motions and or motions won on this basis. So I think it's worth, it is worth taking some more time to look through, but I think you're right. I mean, clearly there are some cases where a claim of anti-competitive conduct was thrown out of court on this basis, on a CSV billings basis, but not, but I don't think it doesn't happen all that often, I don't think. And I guess I'll get back to one of the reasons why I think it turns out that it happens. I guess I'll get to that maybe now. I think that one of the reasons that, in my experience practicing in this space, when defendants are trying to think, here's a complaint, we think of all the defenses you could possibly come up with, and this is one of the ones one looks at pretty regularly as a defense lawyer. Before you go too far, and certainly before you try to make the argument to a judge, you want to say, well, how pervasive is the regulation here? And even within the world of finance, even within the world of securities, depending on what the alleged misconduct is, there may or may not be regulations and active enforcement. And I think the way I understand courts to have interpreted these cases, you know, you really need a regulator who's really focused in order to be able to persuade a judge that they should throw out a case. And that can sometimes be a fact-intensive question. And that leads me to something that I think may be an interesting and perhaps unexpected byproduct of your suggestion, and that is the more, and I completely agree that the regulatory agencies aren't properly equipped and they don't have the culture to do this, so you are left theoretically with some space that's not properly accounted for. But if indeed you do have regulators do a lot more on competition, there will be far more basis for defendants to tell judges that they should throw out this particular case. So it's a bit of a chicken and an egg. You know, there's a balance, and at least that's the way I read the cases, and I suppose it's worth looking at that and thinking about how it's not only that you're solving a problem by pushing more to the regulatory space, you're maybe exacerbating the problem you've identified, perhaps.
You're ceding your 2 minutes.
He's given me back.
I'll cede him too as well, even if I don't have it.
Yeah, you're ceding me something you don't have, but that's good. Yeah. That's always good. the last thing though I want to talk about is about the output point, and I think Larry touched on that a little bit. It's not so much the question of, and I really don't know the answer, what caused the financial crisis, and derivatives, and other things. But I'm not comfortable with the notion that you can compare derivatives to cigarettes, where it's so hard to see what the benefits are, or the ability to, you know, so let's say create cigarettes that are actually not harmful or maybe even beneficial. Whereas I think amongst derivatives, certainly a lot of great harm occurred as a result of some derivatives or the way they were being traded. But I think a finance expert would say, or some at least would say, oh, these can be extremely helpful. And so the notion that we would, I think there are many people who would be quite concerned that with the suggestion that one should reduce the output of derivatives and reduce the innovation, because in my mind, innovation in derivatives includes making derivatives less toxic. And whether or not, but the real question, and that's, I think that's maybe where I'll end, is if our hope is to have innovation in derivatives so that they will be less toxic, a real good question is,
who is better? Who would be better at doing that? Is it the CFTC? Is it the Department of Justice Antitrust Division? Is it, you know, some people say just let the market do what it wishes, and that's those are all different ways to look at it. But I think it is a question of what would be the best way to have safer derivatives rather than just completely reducing their output. And actually, I do have one thing to say, and I will give Larry, if I have a few seconds.
Allow
to say
him to cede what he doesn't have.
Oh, no, I have something to say. Just be careful about there's a distinction between regulation and enforcement, and certainly people at, let's say, the Department of Justice Antitrust Division like to think of themselves as enforcers. I think people at the SEC, or many of them might think of themselves, well, some are in the enforcement people, but many of them think of themselves as regulators. Those can be two different things, and they can operate at the same time. You can be enforcing the law, and someone else can be regulating. And as you said, there are different remedies available. You've talked about that in your paper. I will end there and give Larry a minute.
Tax the toxicity, and you will get, you know, other instruments that will be safer. Tax carbon, and you will get more solar panels.
Ramsi Woodcock will present Antitrust as Corporate Governance. Ed Rock will comment, as will I. And Ramsi will start with 5 to 7 minutes. Ed will go about 5. I will go about 5. And Ramsi will have the rest.
Thanks, Bill.
Must be a full screen here somewhere. Well, down? Oh, right, it's right in front of me. Aha. All right, thank you. Well, I should just, you know, these are small details, but I should just clarify. It is Ramsi Woodcock.
I'm sorry.
That's quite all right. I used to not correct people, but then once, after an entire 3-day workshop, I finally corrected the head of that workshop, and he burst out laughing for about 3 minutes. So I said, never again will I allow people to persist
in error.
Sense of my name. But in any case, let's get started. So the argument here is that this is sort of a project of antitrust colonization of corporate governance. And so the argument is that we need to make sure that we distinguish surplus from cost, and that's something that's not done enough either in corporate governance or in antitrust. So cost is everything that's necessary to induce everyone who's needed to contribute to the firm to actually provide their contribution. So that includes inputs and raw materials. It also includes capital. So it includes rewarding shareholders with sufficient dividends to make them willing to put up the money for the firm and bondholders and so on and so forth. It includes rewarding entrepreneurs for taking risks. It includes rewarding engineers for coming up with bright ideas, paying for patents and so on and so forth. Once we get all of that out of the way, we're left with something called surplus. And the key idea is when you're left with surplus, the question of how to distribute that surplus is fundamentally independent from the question of efficiency, of how to ensure that the firm produces the largest surplus. Once you've chosen to spend the costs necessary to maximize the surplus, you now have a residual question, which is, what do you do with that surplus? And that's the general issue. Now, in particular cases, there is a linkage, and your ability to distribute the surplus may be connected with what costs you actually spend, and I'll get to that in a second. But the fundamental question that that both antitrust and corporate law face is how to distribute a surplus. An antitrust answer through the consumer welfare standard is to give it to consumers. So what does that mean for corporate law? In corporate law, there's been a long debate about what should be done with profits. Right? Is the duty of the board to maximize profits and give them to shareholders? Is it to distribute them in a freewheeling fashion to various factors of production on a sort of ad hoc basis? Is it to give them to workers and so on? And on this account, antitrust, and particularly the consumer welfare standard, answers that question. The answer is you give the profits to consumers, you maximize consumer welfare. And so my contention is that if we take the antitrust consumer welfare standard seriously, there shouldn't be any profit, and so we don't have to worry about whether it should go to shareholders or anybody else. Now, when I say profit, profit is part of that surplus that's generated from production. And so I'm not making, in this, at this sort of abstract level, I'm not making any argument about efficiency. The argument is, once we've spent everything we need to spend to make sure that the corporation is running most efficiently, that it is maximizing the size of the surplus, as a general matter, the basic consumer welfare standard principle tells us that the surplus in its entirety should be left to the consumer. And not given to the shareholder. Now, because the definition of cost includes a return to investors sufficient to make them willing to contribute the funds to have the business operate, this does not mean that the shareholders don't get anything. It only means that they get only what is necessary to make them willing to contribute and not a penny more. So the argument here is that a fundamental a problem that is missed in the literature is that there is a distinction between surplus, which is fundamentally about distribution of wealth, and efficiency, and we need to always keep that in sight. So let me run very briefly through. I've talked a little bit about the corporate mission debate, an ongoing debate about whether we should give profits to shareholders, workers, managers, or consumers. There's a sort of general economic perspective is that you have to give them to shareholders because you have to, only the group that gets the profits has a true incentive to maximize the share, to maximize the surplus. And so shareholder primacy says, well, as a legal matter, the shareholders are entitled to the profits, and as a result, in order to have a maximization of surplus, we have to make sure that they have control over the corporation because they're the only ones who have the incentive to maximize surplus. The corporate social responsibility folks say, well, no, actually, as a legal matter, that's wrong. Shareholders don't have an absolute right to the profit, and therefore, we should worry about maybe giving the surplus to other groups.
1 minute.
So in the current law, it seems to say that the firm has a duty to maximize profits, but that it doesn't necessarily have to give them to shareholders. So let me just skip in this 1 minute forward a bit. So there's cost confusion on both sides here. On the part of the shareholder primacy advocates, there's a faulty belief that the entire profit has to go to shareholders in order to create this incentive to maximize surplus. But that's not true at all, right? I mean, just as a very basic matter, is so long as you give a constant percentage of the profits to any particular group, they're going to have an incentive to maximize surplus because the marginals are correct. So you don't have to give all of it. You just have to give a little. What's that little piece that you give? That's cost. So that's not what we're talking about anyway when we're talking about what should be done with the surplus in the corporate mission debate. Or when we're talking about antitrust. So how can antitrust serve as corporate governance? Well, if we're going to take the consumer welfare standard seriously, we have to recognize that competition is an imperfect tool towards maximizing consumer welfare. Economies of scale, sometimes we need a big corporation. That gives the corporation too much market power. What do we do? Well, antitrust has to recognize a duty to charge at-cost prices independently from
just the duty to compete, to have a fair competitive process. Once we recognize that duty, antitrust is federal law, supremacy clause, state corporate law must yield, and as a result, we should recognize a duty in the board to minimize profit in the sense of giving all of the surplus to consumers.
Thank you, Ramsi. Ed?
Thank you, and Bill's running a very tight ship, so I will try to stick to my time. It's a very creative idea and a very interesting, I'm going to approach this very much as a thought experiment because it's slightly from left field, or maybe right field, I'm not sure which, but it's certainly an out-of-the-box suggestion. But it starts with a very plausible intuition, which is that law, as a general matter, tries to increase social welfare. The marginal cost pricing increases social welfare, so why not enjoin the board to sell at marginal cost pricing, at marginal cost? Why not impose a duty on corporate management to minimize profits, which is what Ramsi wants to do? As he said, it requires that the firm's entire profit be paid to consumers through either lower prices or better quality, and that none be left over either for shareholders, managers, workers, or anyone else. So let me just take a quick step back and rehearse the conventional understanding of director duties. The conventional understanding is that the duty of the directors is to maximize the value of the firm, or maybe as a proxy, shareholder value, subject to side constraints. So the principles of corporate governance say the corporation should have as its objective the conduct of business activities with a view to enhancing corporate profit and shareholder gain, but says even if the corporate profit and shareholder gain is not thereby enhanced, the corporation in the conduct of its business is obliged to the same extent as a natural person to act within the boundaries set by law. So let's now do a thought experiment of how that's different in the world that Ramsi is suggesting. First question is, how do you get directors? Right, in the standard approach, the reason only shareholders vote for directors is because shareholders among the available people to vote have the best incentives for maximizing total firm value because they're the residual beneficiaries. But if the injunction is to minimize profits, then you might think it would be consumers who should vote for directors, not shareholders. How would the shareholders determine in Ramsi's world whether these are good directors or bad directors? But let's push farther on this. Let's consider three cases, right? The three cases that antitrust worries about, or that regulated industries worry about. The first is a natural monopoly, the second is a perfectly competitive market, and the third is imperfectly competitive markets. Natural monopoly, as Harry's casebook makes clear, the natural solution to a natural monopoly is regulation, and public utility regulation is the paradigm. And so what does the utility regulator do? Well, it regulates for price and output. What's then the duty of the directors? If the regulator has already set the price and the output to maximize consumer welfare, what are the directors supposed to do? Let's take the second polar case, which is a perfectly competitive market. In a fully competitive market, competition is going to drive price to marginal cost. And then what are the duties of the directors? They've fulfilled all their duties. Whereas in the standard model, the duty of the director is to maximize firm value. You're in a competitive market. If you don't do a really good job, you're going to be driven out of business by competition. So let's take the third case, which is the case that really Ramsi is focusing on, which is imperfectly competitive markets. And here, as you think it through, first question is, how's the board supposed to know whether they're in this world rather than one of the two polar, rather than the perfectly competitive market? What triggers the shift from one state to another? Here, the comparison case is an interesting one. It's We know that when firms go from being solvent to insolvent, incentive shift, maximizing shareholder value ceases to be an appropriate thing. Somewhere before you become insolvent, it begins to shift the so-called zone of insolvency. And corporate law has wrestled with the question of whether the director's duties shift in the zone of insolvency. We know that once the firm is insolvent, the duty is to maximize the value of the firm for the benefit of the creditors as opposed to the benefit of the shareholders. So these boundary questions are very hard questions. And then finally, and this goes really to the starting point, the notion of fiduciary duties being owed to the firm for the benefit of the shareholders is partly a story about how to allocate surplus. I think it's more a story about how to generate surplus. And in practice, it's a story about how to hold directors accountable. And so then the question is, in Ramsey's world, if you shift the duty to be essentially a duty to minimize profits rather than maximize firm value, how does now this accountability structure work? And in the paper, much of the accountability of directors now has been outsourced to the antitrust regulators, to make sure that the board is minimizing profits. So all of this, as I think through the thought experiment, I come away from it thinking that if you really think, in other words, a version of the standard story, if you really think that firms should be limited to charging price equals marginal cost, then it seems to me you want to legislate it and figure out how you're going to enforce it, leaving the directors in their classic role to figure out how to maximize firm value within that constraint. And let
me stop there. Thank you, Ed. So I will comment on Ramsey's provocative and very carefully written paper from particularly an antitrust perspective. And Ramsey proposes a rule of profit minimization and defines profit as that part of revenue generated by firms that is in excess of what is necessary to make production in some amount of some quality take place. By definition, then, profit is not compensation that is needed to get any contributor to the firm, whether a shareholder, manager, worker, or a creditor to contribute. It is extra. The show will go on. The yardstick for calculating the size of the incentive to engage in valuable conduct is the value of the actor's next best alternative, not the magnitude of the value that the actor will create. Now, profit so understood, which includes a rate of return, in a dynamic human context, would seem to be the null set. In an entrepreneurial economy, no person can know the value of the actor's next best alternative, whether that actor is the customer, the employee, the manager, the director, the supplier, the shareholder, or the creditor. One is constantly competing for sales, inputs, talent, innovation, and capital. One is never in a static position to rest easily and say, well, we have all of our constituents set, and see, we now have a surplus amount of money that we can distribute without risk of missing a step in the competitive race. Every cent is invested in retaining the business, talent, and capital that the enterprise needs to achieve its mission with ever-increasing excellence. Ramsey suggests awarding only marginal damages to any plaintiff that is able to prove that the defendant failed to meet its legal obligation to minimize profits. I have two reactions. First, the simple one. Imagine the judicial and private resources that would be invested to assess the internal cost structure of an enterprise relating not just to the production of goods or services, but also to employment, managerial talent, equity investment, and research and development. The parties must then assess the value of all possible alternatives that were available to customers, employees, managers, shareholders, suppliers, and lenders to determine if the defendant overpaid on a net aggregate basis its constituents. Then imagine the temporal complexity. Over what time period will that assessment occur? And then the fees that would be paid to lawyers, accountants, valuation experts, and industrial organization experts to make these assessments. When the court issues its judgment, the court will obtain from the defendant a single dollar. Will that exercise really assist consumers whose interests Ramsi is trying to protect, even assuming that a court has the competence to render a judgment over and against the business judgment of the defendant's management? Second, Ramsi defines consumer welfare as delivering to consumers the entirety of the gain from trade, that is, the sum of the buyer and seller surplus. I believe economically that that would require pricing along the marginal cost curve up to the point where marginal cost intersects with marginal revenue. Now, I don't believe that a consensus exists that consumer welfare should be so understood. Judge Bork, who I believe first defined the term, proposed that consumer welfare should be understood as allocative efficiency. Allocative efficiency is the allocation of resources in the economy to the use in which they are most highly valued. That has little to do with distributing the gain from trade or the surplus as between buyers and sellers. Under allocative efficiency, buyers, sellers, shareholders are all consumers in their market interfaces and are equal actors in an economy, none of which warrants special treatment. Allocative efficiency, at least as a matter of theory, occurs at a given output level where marginal revenue equals marginal cost. Price is set where that output level intersects with the demand curve. If the price is set below that level, more output will be produced than cost justified, and allocative efficiency will not be served. To charge innumerable prices along the marginal cost curve up to the output where marginal revenue equals marginal cost would require an omniscience that does not exist, big data to the contrary notwithstanding. This brings me to my final point, and that is that the antitrust laws address concerted activity and acts of monopolization. They do not include an excessive pricing provision and obviously have not been so interpreted. I do not believe that microeconomics condemns monopoly pricing, but simply recognizes it as the economically efficient price when a seller's demand curve equals the industry demand curve. Ramsi's world, as interesting and provocative as it may be, seems to be one in which a new legal framework has been enacted and one that provides the government, including the courts, with a regulatory role that may be well beyond their competence. There I yield and return it to Ramsi for his 5 minutes.
Thanks a lot, Bill and Ed, for these very stimulating comments. So I'll just try to, there's a lot there, so I'll try to run through it very quickly. With respect to Ed's point about what the role of the board of directors is in competition, natural monopoly, and sort of imperfect markets. Under my proposal, the board would do the exact same thing in all of them, right? It would seek to maximize the surplus and then give it to consumers. I've not fully understood your point, but it wouldn't have to know where it was, because if it were trying to do this, it would achieve the same result in all three of those environments. So for example, in the competitive market, the invisible hand tells us that trying to maximize profit will nevertheless result in pricing that turns most of the surplus over to consumers. If the board is trying to do that anyway, great. We don't need that competitive discipline, but if it's there, so much the better. Either way, we'd get the same outcome. I do want to make clear that I'm not so naive as to think that there's not such a thing as sort of fixed costs. So the argument here is not that there should be marginal cost pricing. Obviously, there are economies of scale. There's plenty of reasons why we need to have a price above cost. And so I'm sort of in what an economist would call a second best world. So the argument is that whatever that price is that's necessary to cover both the marginals and the fixed, that's the price that maximizes consumer welfare. There may be a distortion that we can't eliminate because we've got those high fixed costs. So And that's part of the reason why I tried to include in the definition of costs things like returns to researchers and engineers and so on, which tend to be fixed costs and very often can rise above marginal costs. With respect to Ed's points, so I appreciate them because they're exactly what I'm trying to push back against. So this notion that any profit is always necessary is basically a rejection of the notion that there can be such a thing as surplus in the economic sense. And I believe that's an extreme position. It is the case that some firms make more than is strictly necessary for them to maximize surplus. Just think about Apple. What's Apple's cash hoard now? Does anybody know? $268 billion cash. Do we really think that every dollar of that is necessary for Apple to be successful now or in the future? And my argument is not, yes, indeed, it is difficult to determine what cost is, and that's why I argue that the penalty should be no more than nominal damages, $1. So I'm not saying that we should transform the courts into sort of global price regulators. The argument, though, is that we should recognize that there is a duty to turn the surplus over to consumers, and whenever we are equipped in some approximate fashion to insist on that, at least by shouting, at least by having a federal judge say it's wrong, then we should let the federal judge do that, even if the penalty is just $1. Finally, yes, we don't have an excessive pricing rule in this country, and we're an outlier. So I'll leave it at that.
That was very succinct. Okay, let's move on to the third paper. And I don't want to mix the name. Is it Ittai Paldor? Will present with Barak Orbach commenting, and Maria Raptis also commenting. And they're going to use the 7 minute, 5 minute, 5 minute, and then 5 minutes for rebuttal rule as well. And we have tried to schedule this so that there's time for questions from the audience at the end. We'll see how we succeed.
I realize I'm what's between everyone and dinner, but time is already heavily regulated, so.
Not gonna be much change. So what I'm going to talk about is the new academic writing, it's relatively new, about horizontal cross-ownership of firms in oligopolistic industries by institutional investors. And my argument in a nutshell is that completely passive cross-ownership by non-controlling institutional investors is competitively benign. And the reason that I make this point is that the opposite point has been made, and just an excerpt, no communication or coordination is necessary for the basic anti-competitive effect, which turns purely on the structural incentives created by horizontal shareholding. So what is horizontal shareholding, and what is the theory of competitive harm that I'm going to discuss? So we've got two firms that are in oligopolistic or a duopoly in this setting, and they've got quite a few shareholders. Each has got quite a few shareholders, and they've also got these shareholders that are joint shareholders. So they own in both firms, but they're not controlling, they don't control either of the firms in any way, and they do not communicate between themselves. Okay, so there's no coordination going on. Now, how does the current theory of competitive harm work? Well, we know that if there is joint control, then we'll just get monopoly prices, right? If there's a joint shareholder that controls both firms, it's just going to cause prices to go up to the monopoly level. It doesn't care where profits flow to or from. Even if the joint shareholder is not a controlling shareholder, we might get a cartel ringmaster, someone coordinating between the firm or between the boards. And again, we'll have a de facto cartel. But the current theory of competitive harm relies on David Gillow's model developed in 2000. And David Gilo has a model where a shareholder controls one firm and has larger financial stakes in the other. And what happens there, so I have 10% of one firm, but I control that firm, then I have 30% of the other firm. And for every dollar that flows to the other firm, to firm B, I make 30 cents rather than 10 cents. So I have the manager of firm A raise prices to prices that are even higher than monopoly prices, so that firm B can then charge monopoly prices, raise its own prices. And firm A, and this is the important observation, firm A is taking a hit. Okay, it's doing something that is not profitable for firm A and for its other shareholders. It's doing this because it's profitable for firm B and me as the controlling shareholder who has holdings in B. I call this, using the oxymoron, unilateral coordination, because it's the first firm that's doing something and then firm B follows suit. And then this idea has now been extended to passive holding by institutional shareholders in both firms. So they control neither of the firms, and they don't coordinate, but everyone knows what their holdings are. Institutional investors' holdings are publicly known, whether or not they're index funds. And then we just extend the previous analysis, the Gilo analysis, to this setting. But the question then becomes, why should managers serve a non-controlling shareholder, thereby breaching management's fiduciary duties and self-harming? I mean, harming the firm that they manage. One answer for this is regular oligopolistic coordination, which might be the case, but doesn't have to do with cross-ownership, right? That's just an oligopolistic setting. You raise prices, you expect your competitor to follow suit. If they don't, you drop prices back. You don't need joint shareholding for that. The other explanation is performance-based compensation that is effectively linked to industry performance. I don't want to go into that in great detail for lack of time. This is not the Bebchuk-Fried kind of linkage, but if someone has come up with a mechanism that links management's performance-based compensation to other firms' profits, then that is definitely competitively problematic. But the story that is now thought to be persuasive is the hope of future gratitude by the institutional shareholder. So management does something that benefits this shareholder because institutional shareholders, BlackRock, Fidelity, are influential, and somewhere down the road, they're going to pay me back for what I've done for them today. And in this setting, I think that actually having BlackRock or Fidelity or any institutional investor holding in the firm that is unilaterally coordinating is actually harmful from the perspective of management and the shareholder. First, it's less profitable, right? If I want to benefit BlackRock, in my story, BlackRock loses 10 cents on every dollar that flows to the competitor and then makes 30 cents with that competitor, so they've made 20 cents. If they have no holdings in my firm, then they've made a net of 30 cents. So if I'm trying to benefit BlackRock at the expense of my own firm, then the best policy is for BlackRock to hold nothing. I can still do the same, have profits flowing to BlackRock's firm, and BlackRock can compensate me somewhere down the road. Second thing is the risk of detection. If BlackRock has no holdings in my firm, then no one has any reason to think that something is going on. If they do have holdings in my firm, then something weird, other shareholders, enforcement agencies may pick up on this and say, well, something weird is going on here. I won't talk about other jurisdictions. And then things are complicated by the idea that, well, because there are numerous institutional investors cross-holding. And when you look at concentration among shareholders, and they have that in the papers that advance this theory, there are always differences in holdings. So BlackRock has more in firm A than in firm B, but Fidelity has more in firm B than in firm A, and so on. And that complicates matters even further because coordination problems emerge. Who do I benefit if I try to benefit Fidelity, then I've hurt BlackRock and vice versa. And finally, there is greater risk of detection because we now have a shareholder who is also an influential figure and knowledgeable of what's going on, an institutional investor that I'm harming. So the real life setting of institutional shareholding makes this idea, makes real markets even less conducive to this. One thing we do have to address is the empirical findings, because there are papers out there finding support for a correlation between concentration among shareholders at the shareholder level and prices. I will refer you to Ed Rock's paper with Daniel Rubenfeld on that, both for lack of time and for lack of anything additional to say on that.
Thank you very much. Barak?
Thanks. So, first, I really appreciate the opportunity to comment on the paper on this topic, and I really enjoyed the paper. It is an important topic. I think everyone in Antitrust is sort of familiar with the topic. Ittai's approach is—I couldn't tell whether it was imprecision in the statement of argument or he has a very strong position. But much of the discussion in the topic is. Suffers from misuse or even abuse of economic terms and legal standards. So I'll make a few five points that explain that or try to explain that. One is the relevant antitrust context. The second is the precision of arguments and statements. Three is the relationships among actions, economic consequences, and public policies. The fourth one would be the meaning of passive investors, and the last one would be what's the significance of communication in antitrust. So first of all, the relevant antitrust context, we're talking about potential anti-competitive effects of vertical relationships, where relationships may be either integration or contract or something on the spectrum. In that sense, it's not surprising that Ittai wrote about it, because much of his work is about vertical restraints or vertical relationships, but the paper itself doesn't mention that. So basically, we're talking about, could they have any effect, any intercompetitive effects for vertical relationship? And this is a topic that is quite known in antitrust to have a diversity of views. And generally speaking, the view that vertical relationships cannot have any anti-competitive effects, therefore they should be per se legal, it is an existing view, but it is inconsistent with economics, even if it's stated with economic terms. So that's one thing. The other thing is that the precisions of argument and statements. So much of the discussion in this topic is related to phrases like tacit collusions or communication or passive investments, and none of these statements are necessarily precise. For example, I will talk about it separately. What does it mean to be passive investor as opposed to active investor? Well, there's a spectrum. It's not clear distinction. That's one thing. The other thing is tacit collusion in economics means an equilibrium that is created, maintained, and preserved without any communication. In antitrust law, because some people like to use economic lingo, it doesn't mean the same thing, because tacit collusion plus factors such as communication may establish an unlawful conspiracy. So the way tacit collusion is used in antitrust law has nothing to do with the economics, or has something to do, it's related, but they're not necessarily related. And the last thing is, and a similar thing is, what's the meaning of communication? And well, we don't need, in antitrust, we actually don't have a requirement for communication. Communication is a super plus factor, but there's no communication requirement. So that was one thing. The other thing is that the discussion of common ownership suggests that we can see or need to have a relationship among actions, economic consequences, and public policies, and very often we don't have that or we don't see that. So we see consequences, but we cannot define or identify the mechanisms that created the consequences. So if we see a parallel conduct, we don't really know how it was established, but we can have a policy that would address us if we think that this is a concern. We don't really need to know the mechanism. Even though it may be, some people may be obsessed with that.
Now, 1 minute.
That's okay. So With respect to passive investment, Ittai's distinguishing is identifying passive investment as if it is clear, and is referring to control as if it is clear. Well, there's no need for control to have influence, and actually control is something which is also vague in and of itself in the context of such corporations. So for example, does it matter whether the investors have a director or don't have a director? Does it mean that they have a lot of influence in say on pay or director appointments and so forth and so on? So passive is today very lucid, and also the concept of passive has changed dramatically in recent years, and investors are much less passive than they used to be. And the last thing is communication. So as Ittai is phrasing it, he wants to see a requirement for explicit communication, which probably there is communication, not explicit communication, but this is not part of antitrust law. You can prove conspiracy without communication. Communication is awesome. It makes proof easier, but there is no need for communication. So that would be a much higher burden. And with that, I will stop here. I'll just say that it is an important topic. It is important. I think the thinking of people evolve about that, so it's important to have a contribution and discussions and have a variety of views about it.
Maria.
So I think it is important to step back and think about how this recent wave of literature really started, and it started with an empirical analysis in the airline industry, which is fairly concentrated. And the analysis purported to find that relatively small cross-ownerships by institutional investors in the airline industry was having price effects. And subsequent writers have used that to say that we need more antitrust enforcement in this area, and Ittai disagrees with that, and I disagree with it as well. I'd like to make three points, one about plausibility, the second about the cohesiveness of antitrust laws, and the third about antitrust in practice, more or less all supportive of Ittai's position. I agree with Ittai and with Professor Rock's work that finds the empirical analysis not entirely convincing. As I said earlier, that analysis was done in a concentrated industry with a lot of public information about pricing. And to use that and talk about cross-ownership as having an effect, a cause and effect relationship, I think is actually pretty far-fetched. The mechanisms that have been written about for how that effect happens, I think are not plausible and don't capture what motivates managers in my experience. In my practice, we don't frequently have CEOs of these very large companies setting price. It's much more often lower level managers, and their bonuses and compensation tend to be set by how well their business is doing. So there's a lot of assumptions that need to be made in order for this to be plausible, and it just in my experience, they're not. More generally though, and I think this is pretty obvious, but it just seems to me that in a concentrated industry, you would expect to see some tacit coordination, and a lot's been written in airlines specifically. So I think we have to be very careful about what we attribute to cross-ownership versus to just the concentration of the industry at the risk of overreaching, which I think we would be if we tried to increase enforcement here. Second, on cohesiveness of antitrust law, you know, I think I very much agree with Ittai that that applying, trying to create a new rule here is redundant because we have Section 7 and Section 1 already. And I would go one step further even, Ittai, and I would say that some of the proposals in the recent literature are out of line with prevailing antitrust law. And here's what I mean. If you consider Section 1, doesn't require you to show effects, but it does require some evidence, right, that prices have been impacted in a market by a purposeful mechanism. And I think it's pretty clear under our case law that conscious parallelism is not enough. And yet here, advocates of more enforcement are saying that we should abolish these ownership interests or reduce them to 1%, even in the absence of purposeful coordination, you know, based on the fact that we think there's some effect. And I think that's tantamount to a per se rule when we can't even trace really the mechanism of what's going on here. So I think in that sense, it goes even beyond the per se rule to say that we need to enforce the law against these institutional investors. And to those who say, no, we do it all the time in the case of Section 7 cases, I would say, then why do we need anything more than Section 7? And the last point I'll just make, if I have the time, is on the practical realities of antitrust law. You know, I think our antitrust laws are not self-enforcing. Everybody knows that. The agencies have to go to court and win in court. And I wonder, absent a blanket prohibition on anything more than 1% of a shareholding, what is it that the agencies would really rely on as evidence in a court case, right? I mean, how would they win this case? And I think that just takes me back to the point that you'd have to demonstrate effects. And I really don't think that once all is said and done, that the economics will bear out and be able to conclusively establish these effects. If we had that, we wouldn't need a special rule. So, you know, I think if I could make one critique of the paper, it would be that the criticism of the writing is not broad enough, right? I think it needs to take into account particularly the point about the cohesiveness of our body of law.
Ittai.
Okay, so it seems that on average I'm okay. With respect to what Barak said, first, vertical relationship, I don't think that plays any role here. I mean, I'd love to be rewriting my previous papers, but that doesn't go that well. There's no story of a vertical relationship here. It's just dealing with the story according to which shareholders are doing something horizontal here for the firms in which they hold. With respect to what is passive investment and what is tacit collusion and what is communication, two things. I will acknowledge that that's a spectrum. It's not you either communicate or you don't communicate. You have earning calls and so on and so forth. And tacit collusion is not a bright line rule. We heard this morning about the international dateline. But first thing, it is the current literature is saying, well, this is just a structural issue. Even if we don't have anything else in place, then the mere structure of the industry is doing the work. And that is something that I don't think is correct. The other thing is, if we do have some form of information sharing or even explicit collusion, then we have antitrust rules to deal with that. And if people are saying more than they should be saying or transferring information which they should not be transferring, then we have laws to deal with that. But the question is whether or not the mere holdings are doing anything more or anything harmful to competition. And I don't think they are. So I'll stop there.
And to our audience, we have 10 minutes to engage in a sort of group conversation on each of the three papers. So we are now inviting all of these active minds that are there and have been sort of considering the presentations and the comments to express yourselves. We have two microphones on either side.
Yes, Jay.
For Professor Weinstein, if you were looking at the effect of Trinco and Credit Suisse, I think you might look at the FCC. And in doing that, you might think about what Larry said about firm or regulatory culture. You went back to the last administration. You had an FCC that I think was willing to regulate in the interest of competition, particularly in the area of big mergers. And you had the net neutrality rules which were put into place and effectively were regulating the internet as if it were an essential facility. now you shift the culture to the new administration, and you know, the opportunity to impose a competition regime is really lost.
So that's a great point, and I talk a little bit in the paper about the range of regulatory agencies, and the FCC is a great example of an agency that has dedicated competition personnel. They have a dedicated competition bureau, and you're right. And under Obama, they were very active, and maybe now they won't be, but they do have it as part of their culture. I think this, you know, they literally have on their org chart a group that does it, right? So, in another administration, you might see that group populate again. And the same is true of the banking regulators. They have smaller groups, right, that do mergers. So there are people there. They have a culture of it, right? There are people there who do that work. But you're absolutely right to point out there's a range of regulatory agency capability and willingness here. I think that's right. And the SEC and CFTC are at the wrong end of that range. And the FCC is maybe at the right end.
Although, is it really, must we be so negative about our regulatory agencies in the sense that with the derivative world, pre, you know, the crisis and Dodd-Frank, they were traded in complete darkness and over the counter, and there was no transparency, and there was no exchange, there was no clearing, and we have CEFs, we've got much more transparency, we've got reporting. It's not perfect, but I think it's a lot better than the dark world we lived in before.
I totally agree with that, and so I wouldn't say they're not doing their job in enforcing Dodd-Frank necessarily, but they may not be so good at rooting out what I would think of as competition problems. So, you know, we can look at the cases they bring, and, you know, they may be doing some things to make sure that CEFs and clearinghouses are taking care of systemic risk. I think that's why they're making sure that prices are less opaque. But I don't think they're doing the competition job. I could be missing stuff. But.
Yes.
So let me push you on the competition.
Yeah.
You're assuming just civil enforcement. What about the criminal interface enforcement, say, for all kinds of manipulation across any number of regulatory agencies that have some market manipulation-like function, whether it's FERC or the CFTC, et cetera, and they're working in conjunction with the criminal division of DOJ?
Yeah, so that's also a good point. I probably wasn't subtle enough about it, but in terms of independent competition enforcement on the civil side, I don't think you're going to see anything at the SEC and the CFTC. Yeah, you're going to see coordinated investigations, and I think there's been great work done there by all these agencies who are involved dealing with LIBOR and things like this, right? So I think you're absolutely right to say if it's a criminal investigation, we're still going to see DOJ involved working with these other agencies who have the sector knowledge, which is great. It's a great marriage, right? So the CFTC can tell the DOJ folks, this is how the derivatives market works, because we don't know. And the DOJ folks can say, well, now I'm seeing competition problems. Now I understand the market. So that's a beautiful marriage, right, when you can get that part, right?
Other questions?
I want to pick up on Ittai's paper, because he didn't have a lot of time to present it. One of Ittai's scenarios is the portfolio manager or somebody else from the asset manager playing the cartel ringmaster role. He passed over it quickly because, as an antitrust matter, liability there is pretty clear. What didn't come through there, but I think it's really quite important, is there are sort of two things that we're now learning about asset management in this world of increasingly concentrated shareholding. One is that there are portfolio managers who are talking about competitively sensitive things with companies when they own competitors. And the second thing we're learning is that most asset managers do not have any sort of antitrust compliance program. And you put those two together, and there are going to be cases. Some of you may have seen the article in the Wall Street Journal about fracking, where some portfolio managers were getting together because they were annoyed that the companies, the fracking companies they had invested in, were pumping without restraint and pushing prices down. And according to the Wall Street Journal, people were calling these guys up or talking to them on earnings calls and telling them to act responsibly. You don't have to be a wild and crazy plaintiff's lawyer, which I once was, to see that there is a really good Section 1 case there. And the level of antitrust awareness in the asset management industry is very low.
So this is good news for antitrust lawyers. So I was struck, Sam, by that paragraph which said, oh, it turns out that two cases, Credit Suisse particularly, the Trico also hasn't had much effect. And of course, it's always a question when to say that it's a small set of cases that rejects it. But what we never know, of course, is when cases aren't being brought, either because there aren't a lot of them, or they don't exist so much, or because litigants, particularly private litigants, say, I'm not going there because I'm not going to make it. And the antitrust division is busy with its cartel cases. So that it partly ties into what Ed's saying. Maybe we'll cure this if everyone thinks there's no antitrust law in this area, and they stop, well, they never pay attention, but it gets out, and now John Jacobson went up.
I think it's a great point. It's really hard to tell, right? So I'm only looking at litigant cases, and you're absolutely right. There may be a range of cases that plaintiffs or the government has just said, we're not going to bother, right? And the effect may be hidden there. I think that's something I should make more of a point of. I agree with that.
Yes.
So this question is also about horizontal shareholding. I know you sort of ran out of time, but would you be able to tell us a bit more about this 2017 study that's on the slide here? The merger between BlackRock and Barclays, and that, how that kind of led to the 3% price increase, and more precisely, what was problematic about that study?
Okay, so the study finds a price increase in the airline industry when concentration among shareholders. What happened was there was a merger, the BlackRock merger, and with no change in concentration in product market in the airline industry, and what happened was prices went up 3 to 7% in an industry in which profits are at around 4%. So that's significant. So there are quite a few issues with the empirical study itself, which Ed Rock and Dan Rubenfeld talk about in an article. More for purposes of my article, this is another thing that I didn't have time to talk about. There are mechanisms that link managerial compensation to industry performance rather than to firm-specific performance, or to the extent that firm-specific performance exceeds market performance. And that is undoubtedly a mechanism that is the economic equivalent of granting managers stock in competing firms, which will cause managers to act anti-competitively. Well, I'm not arguing. I'm not arguing anything. I'm just saying. If you want to empirically test the question of whether or not it's just the structure of the shareholders market or the concentration among shareholders that's doing the work, you need to clean out industries in which what they had in place was managerial compensation that did these kinds of things. And they never looked at it because all these mechanisms are now grouped together. They may be doing this and they may be doing that, and we don't care, but something's going on. They never looked at the distinction between industries in which such forms of managerial compensation were present.
Let me just follow up a couple of things. From an antitrust perspective, antitrust economics perspective, the biggest problem with the Schmaltz study is they don't do anything to, they do very little to control for the endogeneity of HHI. They use the IV analysis to try to control for the endogeneity of the MHHI delta. That's the Barclays BGI merger. But the endogeneity, everybody in antitrust economics knows that HHI can be endogenous as well, which is why it's used as a rule of thumb for where you should look, but not as a legal standard. There's a really good new study out by some folks at UVA and the Federal Reserve, very sophisticated econometric study that says there is no effect.
In the same market?
Yeah,
in that market.
In the airline market. There's also Dan O'Brien, who is O'Brien of Salop and O'Brien, that came up with the MHHI measure, also has an interesting study out. So on the econometrics, we obviously can't go through them today. The question is very much open from an econometric perspective as well.
Okay, we are at the end of our time. I suppose with the indulgence of the organizers, I'd like to offer the presenters one sentence or two to emphasize the thesis that they would like to leave us with. And why don't we start with Ramsi?
if we want to take the consumer welfare standard seriously, then there shouldn't be any profit.
Sam.
Just that we should, you know, pay attention to potential gaps between where antitrust is gone and regulators aren't stepping in. We need to, you know, pay attention to that.
Ittai. Thank you very much for your attention and questions.